Thanks, Brooke. Did the president just hit send on a threat to Bob Mueller? The lead starts right now. Trump v. Mueller, the president sending out a cryptic tweet as his legal team's in a tug of war with the special counsel, prompting speculation the president might make a move and trigger a crisis. A budge from the judge in the Paul Manafort case, acknowledging that his behavior has been less Judge Wapner and more Judge Dredd. Could his behavior sway the jury and set Manafort free? Plus, caught on tape, the head of the House Intelligence Committee confirming what many Democrats already saw as obvious, that he's all about protecting Trump. Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to The Lead. I'm Jake Tapper. We begin with the politics lead. President Trump today seemingly signaling he could be taking some sort of move against the special counsel investigation, tweeting out today a series of debunked claims about the probe before writing, quote, "Stay tuned." Now, what exactly that means, we do not know. But it is worth noting, it was just 8 days ago that the president tweeted that Attorney General Jeff Sessions should stop the Mueller investigation. And, of course, keep in mind, this president did fire the then FBI director with the Russia probe foremost on his mind. Now, any minute we could hear directly from the president as he's hosting a roundtable event in New Jersey. Also possibly factoring into the president's mindset today, the standoff between him and Mueller on whether the president will ever sit for an interview. Trump attorney Rudy Giuliani saying that the president will not answer Mueller's questions about his decision to fire Comey or any request that Comey lay off Michael Flynn. Two issues that Mueller clearly wants to ask about. CNN's Jeff Zeleny is in New Jersey near where the president is taking a working vacation. And Jeff, is the White House offering any clarity on what the president meant when he said, stay tuned? So many people here in D.C. worried he will order an end to the Mueller probe. But then again, as Speaker Ryan told the New York Times, the president likes to troll us.
Jake, perhaps no surprise, the White House is not explaining what the president meant by saying stay tuned, but it is one more sign. This is simply a long rolling show of the summer. Now, on one hand, the president is saying that Mueller is dragging its feet in this, but at the same time, they have not agreed to that interview, of course. But the man at the center of this strategy, Rudy Giuliani, the president's lawyer, he's coming to Bedminster to the golf club for dinner tonight. It's a safe bet that Mueller is on the agenda.
Never mind the legal arguments for President Trump. Today's chapter of the will he or won't he sit down for an interview with special counsel Robert Mueller is also a political one. The president's lawyer, Rudy Giuliani, now bluntly saying the Russia investigation could be a lifeline for Trump in the midterm elections. Giuliani telling CNN the continuance of the investigation would actually help because people are getting tired of it. And the president needs something to energize his voters. Nothing would energize Republicans more than let's save the president.
It's a witch hunt hoax.
The president repeating his rallying cry today on Twitter, saying, this is an illegally brought rigged witch hunt run by people who are totally corrupt and or conflicted. Yet his lawyers still insist they're open to having the president sit down with the special counsel if obstruction of justice questions are set aside.
The reality is he doesn't need to ask a single question on obstruction. He has all the answers. They're not going to change. The president's not going to change his testimony. So stop the nonsense.
Mueller is not commenting on the negotiations. Giuliani is, and seems to be inviting a midterm election showdown.
Well, I think if it isn't over by September, then we have a very, very serious violation of the Justice Department rules that you shouldn't be conducting one of these investigations in the 60-day period.
He's talking about 60 days before the November elections, a Justice Department guideline for candidates on the ballot. Trump, of course, is not on the fall ballot, even if his prestige is.
But it's important to keep in mind the timing of all of this is up to Bob Mueller and the special counsel's office. Also important to keep in mind, he has not said anything throughout all of this process. Now, if this plays out in the next coming weeks before Labor Day and then on to the midterm elections, if Bob Mueller decides to subpoena the president, that, of course, in Giuliani's thinking, would energize his base. But there's no sign or sense that he's going to do that. Jake, the only thing that's clear, the Giuliani side of this, the president side of this, clearly trying to make a political argument in the middle of a legal one. Jake?
All right, Jeff Zeleny with the president in New Jersey. Let's talk about this all with my experts. What do you think the president means when he says stay tuned? Do you think we know that he has contemplated firing Mueller before or ordering the firing of Mueller. Do you think that's what he means?
I mean, God only knows, Jake. This is what he does. I mean, he puts this in the minds of people that it really is about doubt.
He's a magician, or he likes to think of himself as a magician, so only God knows. And part of the segment when you talked about how his staff, his team doesn't know, they really don't know. They often find out on the back end what the president is actually doing. But he wants to seed in the minds of the American people doubt, and he's very good at that.
I would say one thing that Trump does a lot, he'll say stay tuned when he wants to buy himself time. This is a way of creating suspense, suggesting to his followers that more information is forthcoming that will clear him. But one thing that's really funny about his refusal to speak with Mueller, he will pound out tweets every day of the week on this subject. He will talk to Lester Holt, he will talk to Sean Hannity, but he won't talk to somebody when he's accountable for it. And so I think that's a political answer, because he wants to make this thing all political to try to win that argument. But I think people who want to see this investigation come to a close have to put the pressure on that question of why he will talk to journalists but not Mueller.
Well, I don't know if everybody you mentioned there was a journalist, but okay. Sure. I mean, certainly Lester Holt is. Mike, one of the things...
It's also a crime, by the way, if you lie to the press, there's no crime.
But that's true. That's true.
That's an argument the president's made about his excuse for the Trump Tower meeting. Mm-hmm. But I want to ask you about Rudy Giuliani saying that the president will not answer the questions. What did you say about Flynn, and why did you fire Comey, suggesting that it's a perjury trap? Obviously, Comey has a different recollection, let's say, than President Trump. But would that necessarily result in perjury if it's just a he said, he said?
Well, it could, and here's why. So this is why any lawyer, I mean, I hope that he sits down and goes through with the counsel. Here's why it's a bad idea, if looking at it from a lawyer. It's not just that you say it and then the prosecutor says it. If there's another witness that says, no, that's not what happened, now you get a he said, she said, but you get it in court. You get charged with a crime. And I think that's why his lawyers are saying, hey, we don't know who's cooperating, who's saying what. We don't know if they're making it up, not making it up. That's why we can't have you go in and kind of wing it with really important investigation. Again, it's not just that he would lie. Mm-hmm. It might be a witness, and he could, but it might be a witness that comes in and says, I remember something completely different. And if they find another witness that says that, now he's got a problem. They could charge him with perjury.
Yeah, there's the question of whether it's a he said, she said versus, or he said versus he said, he said, he said, he said, and then you have the president on the other side.
But those meetings with Comey, his decision to fire Comey was only in his head. The meeting with Comey, in which he allegedly brought up Flynn, was just the two of them. I mean, I guess there's other meetings in terms of when he talked to Sessions and Rosenstein about coming up with the excuse for firing Comey.
You know, what's so interesting is there's this constant concern among the president's legal team, among the president's advisors, of all of these people around the president flipping on him. Right? There's this fear that all of these people are suddenly going to flip on him, but the question never gets back to, well, what are they flipping on him for?
Right.
And clearly there is this fear there, and the question that Bob Mueller is trying to figure out is, what is this fear of other people flipping, and is there indeed valuable information that they can turn over?
Yeah, but one more point. Why do we think that Donald Trump would actually be interested in bringing this investigation to a close? I know Rudy Giuliani argues that, but they want to push this past the midterms. They need to keep this going, and if Trump refuses to speak with Mueller, he puts Mueller in the position of saying, well, am I going to subpoena the president? And, you know, why would you subpoena the president if you're not going to indict him? And so Mueller very well may just write his report, and we know that Donald Trump is going to write his report, and this thing gets shoved towards everybody at the end of the year.
The only problem there, though, is his son could get wrapped up into this.
Right. And I think more reason to delay it.
I'm not sure I'd agree with that. I think they want it done soon so that there isn't this charges press, that they just come up with a report and somebody doesn't get dragged in front of a grand jury.
Except, Nina, listen to this. So Rudy Giuliani spoke to Dana Bash, saying that he thinks the Republicans might benefit from this if it drags on. He said, quote, "No, I'm thinking the continuance of the investigation would actually help because people are getting tired of it and the president needs something to energize his voters because the Democrats look like they're energized. Nothing would energize Republicans more than let's save the president." So, I mean, there's Rudy once again reading his stage directions out loud, which is, oh, we want to keep this going because it's going to energize our base.
I think a part of that is true. And just to latch on to something Amanda was saying, he really is about the theater of it all, both of them. That's why Giuliani and the president are such a good match, because they have a flair for the theatrics of it, the theater of it all. In terms of this energizing the base, I mean, certainly one snapshot of that happened in my home state of Ohio, in the 12th district in the southern part of Ohio, where it's neck and neck right now with Senator Balderson and O'Connor. So in a district where he won 11% of the vote, he being the president, it is still too close to call. So I'm not so sure this will necessarily energize the base in a way that gets them the political calculus that they're looking for.
Except support for the Mueller investigation keeps dropping as the president keeps waging his campaign against it. In June, 41% of those polled say they approved how Mueller was handling the investigation. That's down from 44% in May, 48% in March. The demonizing of Robert Mueller is working.
It's been incredibly effective, and that's why when you look at what Giuliani has said, you have to view it not only through a legal lens, but a political lens. Because Rudy Giuliani, the reason why he's the president's chief personal attorney is because he also has that political experience, that political lens through which he views the world. And so when he is talking about the midterm elections and the value of drawing this out, you have to take him seriously at that. You have to take the possibility seriously that the president is happy to go back and forth with Robert Mueller, exchanging these letters about a potential interview all the way into the midterms. And that's why when we see the president having dinner with Rudy Giuliani tonight, you have to keep in mind that they're not just going to be talking about that letter, but how many more letters are going to
happen. Mr. Chairman, the Rudy Giuliani said something just completely untrue yesterday, last night on Fox News, about the investigation and how the investigation can't even continue through the midterms. I want you to take a listen to this because as a former FBI agent, you know these facts.
I think if it isn't over by September, then we have a very, very serious violation of the Justice Department rules that you shouldn't be conducting one of these investigations in the 60-day period.
That's not right.
There was an old precedent in the FBI that if you had an investigation that didn't look like it was going to come to any decision within 60 days of an election of an elected official, then you pause for the election to happen. You didn't want to influence it.
Right. You don't make any announcements during it, right?
Right. You can still continue the investigation.
Right.
You can do all of that. You don't stop the investigation.
But that's what he
said.
It
doesn't mean your clock runs out and you're out of your, you know,
no,
you're
but that's Rudy said you shouldn't be conducting one of these investigations with 60 days. That's not accurate.
No, well.
You're not supposed to say something publicly.
Right. They can't come out 60 days
right.
and say, well, guess what? We're going to serve a warrant on your house this week as a part of this investigation. And by the way, it's a rule that isn't really hard-pressed either.
As James Comey showed us in 2016.
Exactly. And while we've seen it in other places, if you look in, you know, public corruption cases around the country, they have dipped into that 60-day rule for whatever extenuating circumstances the investigation.
And the Trump legal team doesn't view Bob Mueller in the same way as James Comey. They don't think that he's going to make the same kind of mistake that James Comey made, as far as they see it, as far as making an announcement too close to the election. They think that he's going to try and respect that.
All right, everyone, stick around. We've got a lot more to talk about. Coming up next, trial and error. The feisty judge in the Manafort trial is calling out his own behavior in court. He did that today. Plus, the ambitious plans laid out today to create the United States Space Force. The Trump administration is all in. What about Congress? What about the Pentagon?
As the sixth branch of the armed forces, the president made it clear.
Today, we saw something of an apology from the judge overseeing the trial for Paul Manafort. That's the president's former campaign chairman facing bank and tax fraud charges. Judge T.J. Ellis admitted he was probably wrong in scolding the prosecution. I'm sorry, T.S. Ellis. And it's not the first time that this judge has come down hard on attorneys working for Robert Mueller. But the bigger question, of course, could the judge's style sway the jury away from the prosecution, away from a conviction? CNN's Kara Scannell has been inside the courtroom watching all of this unfold. And Kara, some of these exchanges have been quite testy, as I understand it.
Jake, that's right. Yesterday, the judge admonished the prosecutors for reminding the judge of his own ruling from the day before. So this morning, he came into court, and after the prosecutors asked him to address this to the jury to kind of remove any sort of stain that might exist, the judge called the jury in, and here's what he said. We have a couple words we can put up. He said, "Put aside any criticism, I was probably wrong in that. This robe doesn't make me anything other than human." So the judge, this is now the 10th day of the trial, and the judge, even from the outset, has been tough on the prosecutors. When they began bringing in their case, they had several vendors that were the people who sold Paul Manafort, his Mercedes-Benz, his ostrich jacket, and the judge criticized the prosecutors then when they wanted to show pictures of this evidence. At the time, here's what the judge said. The judge said, "Look at me when you're Mr. Manafort is not on trial for having a lavish lifestyle." Now, all the criticism of the prosecutors, this is something that does happen in courts. Judge Ellis is one of these judges that really likes to command his courtroom and move it along. But there was even an exchange that took place in a sidebar that was out of the place of the jury, where he was giving the prosecutors again another hard time. And this was where they were just having a discussion. The judge said to one of the prosecutors, "Look at me when you're talking to me." And the prosecutor responded, "These are not tears in my eyes, Judge." And the judge said, "Well, they're watery." So the judge has really been leaning on the prosecutors in this case. The defense hasn't yet began their case in chief, so we'll wait to see if the judge does take a hard line on them. But it doesn't necessarily mean that he's, you know, putting a thumb on the scale. Judges often like to command their courtroom, and this is a case with a lot of documentary evidence. It looks like he's trying to move it along, especially when he sees some evidence that he might view as being repetitive, Jake.
All right, thank you so much. Kim Whaley joins me now. She was an assistant U.S. Attorney. And the concern here is obviously that the judge, in reprimanding the prosecution or the defense, he's reprimanded them as well, might influence the jurors and how they think about this.
Sure. I clerked for a somewhat curmudgeonly judge like this, and he did the same thing. I do think that the jury can see through and focus on the facts and the law. And there's an argument to be made for this kind of tight courtroom actually producing a better result and a better outcome for both sides. It's harder to get away with stuff. And in addition, I think this judge is mindful of a possible appeal. If there is a conviction, he wants to make sure it doesn't look like the prosecution had any favors along the way by him that could be reversed on appeal.
But couldn't it, that's only if there's a conviction, of
Correct.
Course, but if there is not a conviction, the government can't appeal it, that's it, so it doesn't matter. So is it always better to lean on the prosecution to be tougher with them than with the defense?
Well, it, you know, judges handle it different ways. I think, I mean, some of us are old enough to remember the OJ trial where things were just kind of out of control, and that is actually a not a good outcome. But that being said, you know, judges command a tremendous amount of authority, and there might be people on the jury who say, listen, this judge doesn't like this prosecutor, maybe I shouldn't trust the prosecutor. So that is something, I think, to be mindful of. It's certainly not something I think prosecutors are happy about, but is it reversible error? Probably not.
How common are these kinds of reprimands, and how unusual is an apology from a judge?
Now, again, the reprimands really depend on the reputation of the judge and how he or she runs the courtroom. Some judges are extremely cordial and gentle and kind and don't get into that at all. Now, I'm sorry, what was your second question?
The second question is, how unusual is an apology? Because it strikes me that that's not something that a guy like this does easily.
Yeah, that's somewhat unusual. I mean, normally if something like that happens, there could be a request in the jury instructions before the jury goes back to deliberate to say, and maybe this will be included, listen, jury, what comes out of the court from behind the bench is not evidence. But, you know, frankly, I think it was refreshing to see someone in that kind of position of power in this polarized society admit that he made a mistake and that he's only human. And I think we should all kind of take a note from that page.
It's true. We don't see a lot of that in today's society. Kim Whaley, thanks so much. Appreciate it. Secret tape revealed, the House Intelligence Committee chairman suggesting what many Democrats have suspected for months. Hear the recording for yourself coming up next. Thanks so much. Nunes has corrupted the committee he chairs, which has historically tried to rise above the political fray of Washington. The remark was made during a closed-door fundraiser for Republican Kathy McMorris Rogers of Washington State. CNN's Manu Raju joins me now. And Manu, Republicans today are suggesting that Nunes is merely stating what many of them believe and have said publicly, that if Democrats win the House, they're going to begin impeachment proceedings, which they think is inappropriate, and so Republicans need to keep the majority.
Yeah, and Republicans are saying that, but some are not commenting, including the House Speaker, Paul Ryan, who has not said anything about this so far. Neither has Kathy McMorris Rogers, who is part of that House Republican leadership team. She's in a tough reelection fight of her own. And of course, this fundraiser taken at a fundraiser with Nunes and her. And this is all just the latest flap surrounding the very controversial chairman of the House Intelligence Committee.
House Intelligence Chairman Devin Nunes in private confirming Democrats' longstanding suspicions that he believes House Republicans must protect President Trump from Robert Mueller.
So therein lies, so it's like your classic catch-22 situation where, I mean, we're at a, this what puts us in such a tough spot.
Speaking at a private fundraiser for a House Republican leader, Kathy McMorris Rogers, Nunes was secretly recorded, saying the House GOP must retain the majority this fall for one clear reason.
If Sessions won't unrecuse and Mueller won't clear the president, we're the only one. which is really the danger. That's why I keep, and thank you for saying it, by the way. I mean, we have to keep all these seats. We have to keep the majority. If we do not keep the majority, all of this goes away.
It's the latest controversy in Nunes' tenure atop the powerful committee. Last year, he rushed to brief the president about his concerns in secret intelligence reports.
The president needs to know that these intelligence reports are out there, and I have a duty to tell him that.
Despite later stepping aside from running the Russia probe, he continued to exert his influence, quashing Democratic attempts to call witnesses and subpoena records. Privately, he mounted his own investigation into the Justice Department to sow doubt over the Mueller probe, all earning praise from Trump.
It's courageous. Congressman Devin Nunes.
It culminated in the February release of the so-called Nunes memo, where the GOP contended that the FBI improperly obtained a warrant to monitor former Trump campaign advisor Carter Page, a conclusion Democrats reject.
It's appalling. It's a misrepresentation.
Yet Nunes soldiered on, this time threatening to impeach Rod Rosenstein, the man who oversees the Mueller investigation, for not providing enough records to Congress. At the fundraiser, Nunes said impeachment should wait until after the Senate confirms Brett Kavanaugh to the Supreme Court.
I said publicly Rosenstein deserves to be impeached. I mean, so I don't think you're going to get any argument from most of our colleagues. The question is the timing of it right before the election.
Now, as Nunes has demanded more documents from Rosenstein, we have been told by multiple sources that he has actually not read some of those key documents, including one he's demanding now, which is the full unredacted copy of the FBI's application to surveil Carter Page. He wants that publicly released, but he has not gone to the Justice Department to read it. Jake?
All right, Manu Raju, thanks so much. My experts are back with me. Mike Rogers, you used to be the chairman of the House Intelligence Committee when it worked in a much more bipartisan way. I want to play the full comment made by Nunes and get your reaction.
So therein lies, so it's like your classic catch-22 situation where, I mean, we're at a, this what puts us in such a tough spot. If Sessions won't unrecuse and Mueller won't clear the president, we're the only one. Which is really the danger. That's why I keep, and thank you for saying that, by the way. I mean, we have to keep all these secrets. We have to keep the majority. If we do not keep the majority, all of this goes away.
So what Democrats and others, critics of these comments and of Devin Nunes say is, it's not the job of the House Intelligence Committee chairman to protect President Trump. It's the job to find out what happened and share that information with the American people.
Yeah. I don't know if there's a big aha moment. A partisan member goes to a partisan event and gives a partisan speech. Okay. The problem is that the dysfunction of the Intelligence Committee as we used to know it. There is, and candidly, I think both sides have been far too aggressive partisan in these investigations. So now you don't know what's right. The Democrats issue their report. I don't know. Is that right? The Republicans issue their report. I don't know. Is that right? The only way we're going to get to the bottom of what's happening in all of this is through these IG investigations. DOJ is now looking at the FISA issue. They looked at the Clinton emails and they said, yes, there were some mistakes made. And those are important to correct. But what you have now is this absolute scrum on what's happening inside the Intelligence Committee and why partisanship has no business in there. Because we have to remember, they're issuing subpoenas too. Just like you don't want the FBI to be partisan when it issues a subpoena, you certainly don't want the power of a congressional committee in the intelligence business issuing a partisan subpoena either.
And just to remind our viewers, you were the chairman when there was a bipartisan report on what happened at Benghazi, a very controversial issue. What's your take on all this?
Well, it's kind of funny. He doesn't know what a catch-22 situation is, but he is in one because the shady things that he is doing to protect the president are actually putting him on a path to imperiling the president. It's funny to me that this is viewed as somewhat as a Devin Nunes problem. He was speaking at a fundraiser for Kathy McMorris Rodgers, who's number four in the House. I think it's an interesting choice that she has him headlining her fundraiser. She's in a toss-up race. But my question for leadership is that, are you putting your stamp of approval for the House Intelligence Chairman to speak in this manner, to view his role as protecting the president? Because I hear a lot of impeachment talk being tossed around, but the Republicans are the only one campaigning on impeachment. They're saying the situation is so bad that you have to elect Republicans to protect him, and I will use my role as chairman to protect him. That was his message at a fundraiser stamped with the endorsement by Kathy McMorris Rogers. And so if that's the position of the party, is the president more guilty than, I mean, that seems to me a tacit admission of guilt in some way.
The idea that he's actually vulnerable to something coming from Mueller.
Yes, if they're taking it that seriously, that Democrats will impeach the president, then they seem to be very worried about this.
But that's an argument that we're going to hear Republicans making more and more as we get closer and closer to the midterms. I talked to one Republican strategist today who's closely aligned with the White House, who said, yes, you are going to see more people make the same argument that Devin Nunes did behind closed doors out in public, because there is this enthusiasm gap that some of the president's supporters see between the Republican base and the Democratic base. And 2018 is going to be all about turning those Republicans who turned out in 2016 because they supported the president but may not have in the past or in past midterms in particular, and getting them to show up. And one of the ways to do that is through fear, and through this fear of, if Democrats take back the House, if Democrats take control of the Senate, you're not only going to see an impeachment, you could potentially see the president removed from office.
Yeah, so that is a bit of an argument. You see the polling for people in the middle, if that's actually persuasive.
But there it is. I mean, the impeachment process, we all know, is a political process. However, Nunes was telling the truth. I mean, he just laid out there that he cares more about the president and the president holding this office, whether he has done right or wrong, above democracy, small d democracy. He cares more about his relationship with the president. He cares more about protecting the president than he does about the people and getting at the truth. So he laid bare for the American people to see that this is what our job is going to be: to hold the House, to hold the Congress, so we can protect the president, so we can protect our political behinds.
So you're a former Democratic official, a state senator in Ohio.
Yes.
What is the hunger out there among progressives, among liberals, Democrats, for impeachment? Do they want impeachment?
I mean, some do, Jake, and it's not just Ohio. I mean, I've been to about 33 states in the last 10 months, and people really are still very much focused on those bread and butter issues that don't get a chance to bubble to the top, because we have to constantly endure the drama that is this president. And as long as we continue to collectively to play on his ground, his platform, then the greater needs of the American people are never met. Can we look at the investigations? Can we look at all of the things, the strife that's happening in this country, at the same time deal with the very everyday needs? Medicare for all, clean water, you know, and not just in Flint. Even there was a period of time about a month and a half ago where our sisters and brothers in Iowa, for example, nine counties.
Also a problem in Ohio.
And in Ohio, yeah. Lead levels. We never get a chance to talk about those issues because we keep getting trapped and wrapped up into all things President Trump.
We only have 30 seconds, but I do want to ask. He also talked about impeaching Rosenstein after the midterm elections are over, assuming that the Republicans hold on to the majority. No administration member, not including presidents, has been impeached since, I think, 1876, when the Secretary of War was impeached. Do you think that's a good road for Republicans to go down?
Absolutely not. I think it's absolutely asinine that they even talk about it, number one. If they wanted to hold him in contempt, as Eric conversation, they do have an obligation to answer about impeachment. For what? Because they disagree with the direction of the investigation?
They makes want to
no
to stop
sense.
The impeachment of Trump.
Well, yeah, I hear you, and I hear why they're doing it, but I think it's a mistake. The only thing I can say, there are Democratic presidential candidates running on impeachment. So some notion that only Republicans are talking about,
we're not hearing a groundswell of that
among
everyday people.
We're coming back. We're going to have more panel discussion. So it sounds like this is really happening. Today, the Trump administration launched its grand plan to create the Space Force. The new deadline to get it done next. Stay with us. Republican Congressman Chris Collins' Democratic opponent is cashing in after Collins' arrest on insider trading charges yesterday. Nate McMurray revealed a huge surge in donations in the past 24 hours. He said, quote, "We probably raised more this morning than we have in the whole race." Democrats are hoping that Collins' arrest will push one of the reddest districts in New York State into toss-up territory and could help them take back the House. Let's just talk about the midterms in general. Trump won this district by 24 points. Collins got 67% of the vote in 2016. Does an indictment change things, Jeremy?
It doesn't seem like it. I mean, I think I heard today that his opponent, his Democratic opponent, hasn't really raised much money, isn't, you know, there's not much going on there. But it does kind of feed this general notion that a lot of the people who've been associated with the president are increasingly coming under federal investigation or indictments or the trial of Paul Manafort. I mean, Chris Collins, you know, I covered the Trump campaign, and he was one of the earliest Republicans in Congress to support the president.
Oh,
he formed this Trump caucus with, you know, a handful of other members at a time when most Republicans in Congress were trying to stay as far away from Trump as possible. So there, that being said, sources that I've talked to say that they're not particularly close. The president's closer with a lot of other members of Congress. But nonetheless, there is kind of this stain of Chris Collins' association with the president, and how that carries forward is up to the voters.
And Democrats in 2006, when they took back the House back then, they did this thing about a culture of corruption. This is after the Mark Foley scandal. You survived that. But is that...
Oh, you pointed right to me like it was my fault.
It can be tough when there are headwinds already for one party to have individual members of that party get in trouble with the law.
No, completely. And I don't think it's enough. I think this is a pretty unique case. I've read the indictment. You know, looks pretty clear cut to me. I think he's going to have an uphill legal battle in that. But to swing those numbers, what they'll start doing is feeding the conspiracy theory that, well, the only reason this happened is for that reason. Is that enough to save him? I'm not sure. I think that Republicans will make a big mistake if they're only centered on we need to be there for Trump. What we find with Republican voters now is that they're saying, don't like the persona, love the policy. So I can hold my nose for some time because I like the policy that's being implemented. Republicans need to go back home and talk about economics, jobs, the economy, education, healthcare, all the things that there are Republican and conservative answers for, and things that they have accomplished. You know, small business, through some of the regulatory relief, is hiring more people than ever, including African Americans and Hispanics and minority populations in a way we haven't seen in a long time. That's what they need to be talking about. I'd get away from all of this other stuff.
And what do you think in terms of Democrats using the Chris Collins indictment as a way to paint a picture of a culture of corruption? He's certainly not the only one. You got Manafort, you have Rick Gates, you have Scott Pruitt and his ethical problems, et cetera.
This year, it's the gift that keeps on giving ever since the president started. You know, he talked about draining the swamp, but it's his swamp. So you drain other folks' swamp, but not your swamp. He keeps filling it up. But, you know, Jake, dealing with that is one thing. I mean, that is a reality, so say it, politically say it. But also the other side of this is that what are we running for? So, yes, the Democrats should point out the atrocities that are happening under the Republicans, but they also have to say to the people, but this is what we will do when we get the power. It can't be a one-sided proposition to motivate people to come out to vote. You have to continue to talk about what you're going to do when you get the power.
I would say one thing about the Chris Collins scandal is it doesn't just end with Chris Collins. There were other Republican House members who also held that stock. Douglas.
Yeah, in fact, let me put up the full screen if I can. Here are four others. Washington Post reporting they also currently invested in the drug company, the biotech company. Collins was on the board of Congressman Culberson of Texas, Lamborn of Colorado, Mullen of Oklahoma, Long of Missouri.
And then also it dovetails with Tom Price's resignation, the former Health and Human Services director who resigned. And people think it was mostly because of the expensive plane rides that he took. But he also was grilled by Democrats on Capitol Hill, especially during his confirmation hearings, about the health stocks that he bought and traded and sold while he is a member of Congress with oversight over those issues. And so this does get into a Trump issue, a Republican issue. And my goodness, there's all these scandals going on that we don't even have a chance to talk about what's going on with Wilbur Ross right now, who's the secretary at the Department of Commerce. And so this is a bigger issue that dovetails with a lot of culture of corruption themes that Republicans haven't even had time to answer for.
Yeah, I think it also flows from the, you know, Democrats have made this argument that it flows from the top, right? And we've seen the president have kind of a different attitude about ethical laws, about, you know, his practices with his business, you know, and so obviously Democrats are going to say, look, this is the president, this is the Trump presidency, this is the Trump era, and it's bringing all the Republicans together.
All right, turning now to the battle for control over the final frontier. Vice President Pence today announcing the creation of a multidimensional space force. Because of the way this proposal's been presented and scoffed at, there's been a lack of serious discussion in the public sphere of what many experts consider to be a legitimate need for the U.S. to fend off imminent threats from adversaries such as China or Russia, who have, quote, brought new weapons of war into space itself, as Pence reiterated today. CNN's Barbara Starr now at the Pentagon picks up the story.
President Trump calling for a radical change in U.S. war fighting.
So we have the Army, the Navy, the Air Force, the Marines, the Coast Guard. But we have the Air Force. Now we're going to have the Space Force because it's a whole... We need it.
Today at the Pentagon, Vice President Mike Pence unveiling details of the White House plan.
The time has come to establish the United States Space Force.
Pence making the case the U.S. is under threat.
Russia and China to North Korea and Iran have pursued weapons to jam, blind, and disable our navigation and communication satellites.
In 2007, China used a missile to destroy one of its own out-of-date satellites. What if it had been targeting U.S. satellites?
What that means is that it put every single thing that we have in space at risk. That includes GPS communications. It includes all of the communication satellites that we have, all of the things that we depend on nowadays for our daily life, was all of a sudden put at risk by that one action by the Chinese in 2007.
The Kremlin working on a similar threat.
Russia's been designing an airborne laser to disrupt our space-based system, and it claims to be developing missiles that can be launched from an aircraft mid-flight to destroy American satellites.
Defense Secretary James Mattis was initially unenthusiastic about adding more bureaucracy to the Pentagon, telling Congress in 2017, "I do not wish to add a separate service that would likely present a narrower and even parochial approach to space operations." Mattis now says he's on board with the plan. Congress would have to approve a new branch of the military, and there are questions if more military offices are the right solution for a 21st century threat.
I think this is maybe the wrong bureaucracy for the problem.
And if there was an attack against a U.S. satellite, well, one analyst says it could push American life back into the 1940s and 50s. No internet, no weather forecasting, no online activity. Jake?
All right, Barbara Starr at the Pentagon for us. Thanks so much. Was it really a makeshift shooting range used to train children to be terrorists right here in the United States? Coming up next, the text messages raising new suspicions about the compound where 11 children were found abused in New Mexico. Stay with us.